Hi, everybody.
Hello, everyone.
Welcome to our online celebration. I trust that you're going to be blessed and experience the power of the Holy Spirit as you're watching today. My name is Paul, and this is my wife, Kiara O'Neill. We're the senior leaders here at Kingdom Ministries Church in Valcom, South Africa.
Yes, we're really passionate about the kingdom of God advancing. Yeah. We love to see heaven invade earth. We love the move of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
So be ready to be convicted by the Holy Spirit. Be ready to grow and be ready to be encouraged today.
Yeah. We love the kingdom of God. We love people. We love the word of God. We love the Holy Spirit. And so our hearts burn to connect people to Christ and His culture. We want to see heaven invade earth in our lives, in our city. We want to see healings and wonders and signs. So this is what our hearts burn for. We as a church love to train and equip people to see them become victorious, mature sons and daughters of God. This is what we're passionate about. So enjoy this Sunday morning with us.
Yes, enjoy the praise time with us.
Yeah. Say good morning to you. Good morning. Goeiemôre. Salagashle, Hambagashle. I don't know which one it is. Forgive me. Dumela. We were away with some men on a men's retreat, and it was really good. And men's lives got impacted and changed. And I think one of the things that stood out for me is that the body of Christ, we really are family. And the only thing we have in common, listen carefully. The only thing that we have in common is Jesus. Come on. If you go to a church where your color skin is in common or your language is in common, that's a problem. Yeah. But we only have one thing in common, and His name is Christ. And I love Him, and you love Him, and that brings us together in a family. And this family may be different to others, but that's the choice. It's a family. Yeah. And so what I saw with the men is we were all different kinds of nations and colors and types, sizes, but we all love Jesus. And that's what makes us a family. So, I'm going to get into the Word. I'm really, in my spirit, I got something. I don't know if I should release it now, but we'll see. So open up to Anywhere Good, please. You can open up to Galatians 5. So thank you, Father. Thank you that you are working in our lives. And I just want to continue with that theme of breaking off the shackles off of our lives. Breaking off the shackles that we've been bound in, even if it's shackles of boredom. And that I pray, Lord, we would start to love your word again. We'd start to read it. We'd start to eat it. We'd love your word because your word sets us free. So I pray that shackles will fall off today. And that we'll have life and life in abundance. New levels of joy, new levels of peace, no matter what happens around us. We'll be focused on Christ. I pray for it. I pray, Lord, touch us with your word. Holy Spirit, write upon this word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So I've got a little bit of a salad today. It feels like it. It's not just steak, it's a bunch of things I'm throwing together, and I hope that something's going to penetrate your hearts, and that you'll walk away with hope, you'll walk away with an answer, you'll walk away changed. All right, so I pray that the Lord stirs a fire in you this morning, even through the worship, that there'll be a fire that just stirs, awakens you to something fresh in the Lord. And the one thing I want to, the one thing I hope is going to happen is that we're going to walk out here with an understanding of, we want to make Jesus famous. Amen. We want to make Jesus famous. Amen. And so the question is am I making myself famous, or am I working my whole life to make Christ famous? That's a question we can start on. And the way I live, the way I conduct my life, my day, my work is, I'm either going to be building my kingdom or I'm going to be building his kingdom. And if I build my kingdom, I'm making myself famous. If I'm building his kingdom, I'm making him famous. Remember, we're not just trying to build a church. We're building the kingdom of God. It's God's reign and rule. As it is in heaven, so it is on earth. So that the Holy Spirit feels as comfortable in heaven as what he does in my life, in my home, in my workplace. And so when I build a kingdom in my business, in my shop, in my family, in my environment, oh, the Holy Spirit comes and resides there because I'm building his kingdom. I'm taking the principles of the kingdom and I'm living them out day to day, not only Sundays. Yes. Not only Sundays, eh? So guess what happens? Today we come and celebrate. Tomorrow morning we start working. And not a dead work, a good work, because tomorrow morning we're building the kingdom wherever you go. Sounds like, oh me or eh now, which one is it? We're building the kingdom. And so, yes, a statement that I love to quote, the kingdom in you will always be the kingdom around you. If there's peace and joy in you, there'll be peace and joy around you. Yeah? What is the kingdom of God? It's righteousness, peace, and joy. So 33% of our lives, if you want to call it like that, I know Debbie's like, that math doesn't work because that gets to 99%. But 33% of our lives should exude righteousness. I'm in right standing with God. There is an integrity about my life. There is a steadfastness about my life. There's a faithfulness about my life. 33% of our lives should be exuding joy. You know what would be cool? It'll be great if the world starts to criticize us because we're too happy. They should be writing articles. Did you see those happy clappies? Those guys are off their knockers. They are crazy because they're so full of joy. And 33 of our lives should be exuding peace. Come on, church. And you know what? It's not about righteousness, peace, and joy in these few hours we're together. It's our entire lives. It's all the time. And so, yeah, we're on that track and we're off that track. But the point is we're building the kingdom of God. And the fruit of that will be righteousness, peace, and joy. Come on, so good. Who doesn't want that life? And that life comes because you got a life-giving spirit inside of you. So there's life that flows out of us. Yeah, come on, man. So for that to happen, we need to be believing like sons of God. Amen. We need to start believing like sons. And this one thing I keep saying, just in my prayer life that I started to change, I've started to say, my Father, my Father. My Father. Not just my God, but He's my Father. And Pastor Eddie's always saying now recently, and I am His Son forever. Forever I am His Son. Forever you are His daughter. Forever I am His Son. I am His Son. He is my Father. I am His Son. And I need to declare that, because the more I declare that, the more I'm going to believe it. And the more I believe it, the more I'm still going to start living it. He is my Father and I am His Son. What can man do to me? Maybe let's start there. Let's go there. Let's turn to Psalms 56. So we'll go to Galatians 5 just now. Psalms 56. I hope you got your iPads or phones open, because I'm not hearing any Bibles. So on that matter, on that point, saints of God, the army of God, can I ask you two things? Sunday mornings, don't come late. Be honorable. Have integrity. Come early. Come and pray. Come and love people. You're not late for work. Don't be late for God. I want to ask you that. Number two, have your Bibles with you. Don't leave your sword at home. The enemy's going to clap you for six. Have your Bibles with you. If it's on your iPhone, good. I didn't say Samsungs. I said iPhones, all right? So, sorry. Psalms 56 says, "Oh God, have mercy on me, for people are hounding me. My foes attack me all day long." Maybe you don't have that like David, but maybe you have those little terrors that are just biting at your heels all day long. Those situations that you can't get out of. He says, "I am constantly hounded by those who slander me." You are constantly hounded by the voices in your head. Just quit. Give up. Don't pray. You're constantly hounded by the temptations of the world. It says, "And many are boldly attacking me." But listen to this. I love this. "But when I am afraid," anybody been afraid here? "But when I am afraid, I will put my trust in you." You see, David knew that when he gets afraid, he's got a choice. Is he going to keep being afraid, or is he then going to say, "God, I put my trust in you"? You see, it's at that moment of fear, you got to turn to God and say, "I put my trust in you." Amen. See, you have the ability to choose. "But when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. I praise God for what He has promised." What? David, you're saying that when you're afraid, at that moment of fear and afraid, you turn and trust God and you start to praise Him right there because you know the promise? What is your promise? Do you know the promises of God? Because I can tell you this, if you don't know the word, if you don't know the promises, you're going to stay and remain in fear. Come on. I love what Prophet Ed said about Peter. You know, Peter got a prophetic word, is that right? That he was going to live to an old age, he'll die when he's old. And when he was in prison and they wanted to kill him, he wasn't afraid because he had a word. It's like, "I'm not going to fear, I have a word." So what is your prophetic word? "I'm not fearing I'm going to die. Not anytime soon, because I have prophetic words over my life that haven't come true yet. So they need to happen. So I'm not fearing death." What is the word over your life? If you don't have a promise, or if you don't have promises out the word, you'll start fearing, and fear is going to choke the life out of you. So listen to what he says. "I praise God for what He has promised. I trust in God. So why should I be afraid?" Why should I be afraid? I love the next one. "What can mere mortals do to me?" Another version says, "What can man do to me?" What can man do to me? If you've got a promise of the Lord and that moment of fear arises, you turn away from that fear and you say, "God, I trust you in the circumstance." Is the fear still there? Yes. Is the circumstance there? Yes. But I'm not focusing it. I'm trusting God. And in that moment of trust, I say, "Praise the name of the Lord, because I have a promise." So I'm praising you, God. Great is the Lord. And the more you praise God, the more fear gets so anxious and so upset that he can't handle it. Can I ask you this? What is fear? Is it an emotion or is it a spirit? It's a spirit. Where does fear come from? Does it come from heaven or from hell? Hell. All right? So the spirit of fear can only have one characteristic. Fear, let me talk about joy. What does joy do? Joy is full of joy. Strength. Can the spirit of joy cry? Can the spirit of joy be depressed? No, the spirit of joy carries one characteristic, and that is being joyous. Yeah? You got me? So fear, the spirit of fear can only do one thing. The spirit of fear can only fear. The spirit of fear cannot be joyful. Are you with me this morning? So the spirit of fear can only fear. So this, let me put it sarcastically. This poor spirit can only do one thing in his whole life, and that is fear. The spirit of fear can do nothing else but be full of fear all the time. Jeez, that's terrible. The spirit of fear cannot be happy. So guess what? The spirit of fear fears that when you stand up as a son and daughter of God, as a son, as a mighty, mature son of God, that he's in trouble. So the spirit of fear continually fears you. The spirit of fear continually fears you, because when you stand up and be that mighty man, he's in trouble. So the spirit of fear attacks you with all that it has. What has the fear got? Fear. And it attacks you with fear. And when it attacks you with fear, we are so scared of the spirit of fear, we bow down to it and it controls us. But if you realize that the spirit of fear can only do one thing and fear, you just kick him out. Amen. So you're not allowed here. I shared with you guys about 2 weeks ago. About a month ago, I was sleeping. I think it was like 3 or 4 o'clock, and I felt a demon enter my room. I know these guys. I felt him. I know. Okay, there's this thing's there. I woke up and I immediately started to pounce. I'm like, there's a demon in my room. And I learned from experience, I'm not going to entertain this thing, and he's not going to rob me of my sleep, because my sleep is given to God. And so when I felt that thing, for about 15 seconds, I said, you better get out of this room now. You're not welcome here. You're bothering my sleep. Get out. And I turned around and I slept. That morning, Ava Lee came into our room. And she said to us, Daddy, somebody was in my room last night. Because we got the sensor. Funny thing, there's a sensor under one of the girls' beds, and when they put their feet on the floor, the lights go on so that they can see where they're walking. Yeah. Isn't that smart, eh? So she said, Daddy, the lights went on, and there was someone in our room last night. Now, what is that? That demonic spirit is looking for a place to rest. Yeah. But if you give him access, and if you want to try and fight this thing now, no, we don't get into fights with them. We tell them to get away. And so when I knew that, she felt that immediately, and I knew that something was trying to visit us that night that is not welcome. But instead of panicking and throwing up everything and trying to, I said, you are not welcome in this house. Get out. But these things are real. And fear comes when I'm afraid. That is the test to say, am I going to say yes to this, or am I going to praise God? So the Word gives us, He gives us a strategy on how to exit this, but you've got to use it. So can I share that with you again? When you're afraid, turn, trust God, give Him praise, and fear cannot handle it. Come on. Are you with me? What can man do to me? You see, my Father is not fearful. My Father is free. And I've been made in His image, and so are you. So when you're experiencing fear of the future, fear of COVID, fear of the government stuff, whatever, listen, the world is full of attacks. But the more attention you're going to give them, the more they're going to come to you. It's like you draw them on. You know that you can draw things onto yourself? And we sing and we praise God, but in the week we're drawing these things because we give them attention. Do not give demons any attention. Do not give the demonic world attention. You're sons of the God. You're sons of God. You're seated in heavenly places. Are you seated between heaven and hell? No. You're seated at heavenly places. Are demons welcome in the presence of God? Is fear welcome in the presence of God? No. So don't give them any time. Come on. Are you with me? I don't know why this is a bit off topic of what I was going to go, but I'll get to my notes now. But I sense like we're inviting fear to come upon us, but God has not given us a spirit of fear. So if my father doesn't give me that, I don't want it. You know that you can dodge bullets. You dodge that bullet. When fear comes against you, you say, is this from my father? No. So you get a pass by. Pass by. Next. I'm not receiving that stuff. I'm not receiving that accusation. I'm not receiving that shame. I'm not receiving that guilt. And I'm definitely not going to receive that fear. It's not for me. Because I trust in God. Because I have a word. I have a promise. And God's promise is this. And I will stick to the promise. Come on, church. This is what we're called for. We're not called to live under fear. We're called to live under greater things. See, God wants to anoint you for greater things. Can I just say that again? God wants to anoint you for greater things. But sometimes the very thing I desire, I fear. You've been there? The very thing you desire, sometimes you fear because you know there's going to be a cost into this. Let me share with you a story quickly. And stories are powerful. Before we get to Galatians 5. 12 years ago, I was living in Pretoria. And I was running a business with a friend, and then I was trading in a company. And I was kind of running away from God. Anybody been running away from God before? Like, you know God's calling you and you're running a bit? No one knows what I'm talking about. All right, thanks. Feel free. And I was running from God's purposes. Listen guys, I attended church in Pretoria, but I didn't serve God. I was just attending. Been there before? I was attending because it was the right thing to do, but I attended because I was looking for my wife. And I knew that there's good girls in church. And so the Lord started to speak to me. And the Lord started to speak to me in a period of 9 months. This is in 2010. And in those 9 months, he asked me 3 specific questions because I was getting restless in my heart about what is my purpose, God? We have an assignment. And I realized I'm not living my assignment. I'm existing, but I'm not living my assignment. There's an assignment on your life, and you need to live that assignment. You need to discover that with God and live it out. And don't delay. Do not think your assignment is for when you're 60 or 70. And for the older folk, do not think that your assignment has ended at 65. Your assignment goes with you. You never stop your assignment. That was the gift God was given for you for your life. It's your path, and that path doesn't end. There's no retirement in the kingdom. We keep building the kingdom wherever we go. So, the Lord started to speak to me over this 9-month period. I just want to get to make sure that I'm not missing anything. I was living a great life. I was enjoying. I had great friends in Pretoria. But there was this thing in my heart where I knew I wanted to go back into ministry, but I was afraid of the very thing I desired. I was enjoying work, but it wasn't satisfying. And so I wanted to go, but I was afraid because I knew there's a cost to pay. And so there were 3 questions the Lord asked me over a 9-month period. I remember them clearly. I remember where they happened, and they were spaced out 3 months. That's how the Lord worked with me. And the first question that the Lord asked me, and I know this because I actually journaled every week back then. And the first question the Lord asked me, he says, Paul, will you surrender to me? I said, Lord, but I'm going to church. He says, no, you're attending. You haven't surrendered. You're living your own life. You're building your own kingdom. You're not building my kingdom. Listen, by attending doesn't mean you're building. You're just attending. And I knew what the Lord was doing, but I was afraid. And so he said, "Will you surrender to me, Paul?" And I said, these were my words to my father. I said, "Hell no, leave me alone." True story. And it took me 3 months before I said yes. And on that day I said yes, I still journaled it down and I said yes, because the Lord was working with me. You know when you say no, Lord, and then he starts working with you? And then he eventually said, "Yes, Lord, I'll start serving you." And the next day, my car got stolen. I wrote it in my journal. I forgot about it. I didn't know the days. And my car got stolen the next day. And like we heard with Prophet Ed, the devil's not after your car. He's not after your house. He's not after your job. He's after your faith. And so when I said yes, the enemy came, stole my car. I didn't realize the story. Now I look back and I realize, okay, this is what happened. He wanted to stop my faith. And this is what we have. You cannot have faith and fear at the same time. And he stole my car. And the next week, the Lord asked me the next question. I know exactly. I was riding out of a Catholic monastery in Dundee. And I was surprised by these nuns that were living in this monastery in the middle of nowhere, serving God. And I was riding out Blukom Burma. You know when God speaks to you in those moments and you like get a photo? You know, you can't forget that. And the Lord, as I'm driving out there, the Lord said, "Will you serve me again?" The first one was, "Will you surrender?" Next one is, "Will you serve me?" And when he said, "Will you serve me?" My answer to God was, "Hell no, God, leave me alone." Meaning, I'll love you, but I'm not going to go over the edge. I'm going to build my own kingdom parallel to yours. My story. This is my story. 3 months went by, and as those 3 months were going by, the Lord was working with me through conversations. And eventually I said, "Yes, Lord, I will serve you again." The next week, the Lord asked me the last question. Through a person that phoned me, I was standing in a shopping center. I was just getting out of my car, and this brother phoned me, and he said, "Paul, I had a dream about you last night." And I said, "What was?" And he said, "I saw you in the belly of the fish, and the Lord wants to spit you out." And the Lord said, "Will you obey me again? Will you surrender? Will you serve? Will you obey me?" Was I a Christian? Yes. Did I go to church? Yes. But I was building my kingdom. Will you obey me again? And I love what John 14 says. It's so simple. John 14, 15 says, "If you love me, obey me." Don't say you love me and don't obey me. If you love me, obey me. And so this guy was in this phone. I heard the words. Says, the Lord says, "Will you obey me again?" And I said, "Hell no." I knew what he was asking now. I knew it. He was pressing me in a corner. If you say God doesn't put pressure on us, God can put pressure on us. He pushed me in a corner. He said, "Will you obey me?" And I said, "Lord, hell no, leave me alone. I know what you're asking, and I don't want to pay this price." And as those 3 months went on, I realized that I was in the middle of the fish's belly, and God wanted to spit me out. But you know what? You can remain in the fish's belly. You can be a son and daughter of God, but you can remain in the fish of a belly because you haven't said, "Yes, Lord, use me. Here I am." And so I realized that I could stay in that place. I'm loved. Yeah, I'm loved, but I'm pretty useless at building the kingdom. Are you with me? And so after 3 months, the Lord said, "Are you ready to obey me?" And I had to do something specific. I had to go to my dad and say to my dad, "Do you need my help?" And I feared that day. I met him at the airport. He had to fly to Italy to go to a conference. And I feared that day because I knew what he was going to say. He was going to say, "Yes, come and help in Valcom." And I said, Lord, send me to Timbuktu, send me to Nigeria, send me to Mother Russia. I'll go there, not back here. you know what I'm talking about, guys. And so the Lord said, will you obey me again? And I went, and my dad said, yes. And I said, the Lord said I must come. And I had to give up my job. I had to give up my friends. I had to give up my life to come and serve the kingdom. But this is how the Lord works in us. Because I realized I didn't want to stay in the belly of the fish. I want to read you my own journal from 5 March 2011. And this is when the Lord was busy with me. 5 March 2011. I just took it because yesterday I realized that the Lord wanted to do something today. So this is what I wrote. When the love of God has been poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, we deliberately begin to identify ourselves with Christ's interests and purposes in our lives. And Jesus has an interest in every individual person. We have no right as sons of God to be guided by our own interests and desires. In fact, this is one of the greatest tests of our relationship with Jesus Christ. The delight of sacrifice is that I lay down my life. But when we totally surrender to Him, that's great. Paul said that he knew how to be a doormat to serve others without resenting it, because the motivation of his life was his devotion to Christ. I tend to be devoted, not to Christ, but to all the things which we can get from Christ, the blessings, the freedom, etc. For someone that is in love, it is never about the things. It's always about the devotion to the person. Paul was in love with Jesus Christ, and this showed in obedience. The modern-day church's idea of a servant of God is not at all the Christ idea. His idea is that we serve Him by being servants and the servants of others. Jesus Christ said that in His kingdom, the greatest one would be the servant of all. Matthew 23. The real test of a son is not the willingness and ability to preach the gospel, but one's willingness to do something like washing feet. That is, to be willing to do things that seem unimportant in the human estimation, but count as everything to God. It was Paul's delight to spend his life for God's interests in other people, and he did not care what the cost was. This might be a heavy pull to swallow, but I cannot leave you as a shepherd thinking that my attendance is building the kingdom. I got to point my life towards building the kingdom and saying, God, I'm going to do something for Jesus Christ. I got to take what you've given me and not just worship you, but I want to worship you. I want to love you by obeying you. And so the question is, what is Jesus asking you to do? What is Jesus asking you to? Who is Jesus asking you to serve? Who is Jesus asking you to love? You see, this is a life where we're not building our own kingdom, but we're saying, God, because you are worthy, I give my life towards building your kingdom. Because the kingdom, I build the kingdom in me, but then I build the kingdom around me. And everyone starts eating off the fruit of my life, and they are blessed because I've built the kingdom in me. This is what God is calling us to, church. This is the freedom He's calling us to. But can I just say one thing? If you're going to stand at the door of fear, and you're going to be facing fear continually without looking at Jesus and giving Him the praise, you will not cross that line. You'll get stuck here, and all of a sudden there'll be more and more excuses coming out for why I am not living the calling of God in my life. Because the fear is real. That spirit of fear is real. But it's not been given to you. It's not your portion. It's not yours. It's in that moment that I turn to God and I say, God, I trust you. I don't know the future, but I trust you, God. And I keep praising you. And my answer will be, yes, Lord. Maybe it'll take 3 months like mine, but it will be a yes eventually. Yes, Lord, use me in my school. Now, maybe your call is different. Maybe you don't have to go into what we call these days as full-time ministry, but you are already in full-time ministry. If you are a son and daughter of God, if you said yes to Jesus, you are in full-time ministry. Your full-time ministry might be in the mine, it might be on the farm, it might be in the school, it might be in the business, but you are in full-time ministry and you're giving your life in that area to say, the kingdom is going to come here. Will you allow Jesus? Will you allow him to be that Lord where you say, fear is no longer going to be an excuse. I'm saying yes. I'm going to step out. And listen, don't think I had it all together 11 years ago when I moved here. By the way, I was 31 and I had to move back into my parents' home in Valcom. Fun times. I haven't lived at home for 12 years. Fun times. And the Lord works on us. But all he's looking for, he's just looking for yes. He's not looking for that you try and figure it out. He's figured it out. You just say yes. And you say yes to the King and his kingdom. He works it out. But this is the adventure of freedom he's calling you into. See, it's not a freedom that I live for myself. It's a freedom that I live for him. I want us to stand. See, the right response to believing him is going, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. That's the right response. Yes, Lord. Let's pray. Gregidasta palaganamong. Hafta pushti piligista patamanga. Ye brigita palageshi zefe mongum brigita la balaganda. Lafta shistif to no shizefa mamma mala genginest. Ribidiki palagasha zuputamangam balagete putumoshi zefta mara. Rika palagata pu ramanashtafta malangam balageti pidi bush zingin. Rukumangam balagastapata. Saints, my children, arise in faith. Arise in faith. Arise in belief. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. Arise in faith. I am your Father. I am your Father. I am your Father. You can trust me. Do not allow excuses any longer. You can trust me. Arise in your faith that I have given you. Can we just speak in tongues just in this room? It lifts our faith up. Come on, it's the time for playing games is over with the Lord. It's over. He's calling you. He's calling you. He's calling you this morning. He's calling you this morning. No matter what your age, he's calling you. Build with me, son and daughter of God, he says. Build with me. Brigamasta mongombala kata paragan. Ya brigitif to shuzafa malagatindi. Lambam bruka palagashi zifta pa. Kimbi timonongombam braka malagashi zenge. Yim brigidara palagashi zifo foromongo. Langa ramanaka. Rigitishti tifto no. Zingrigina malagata tanamo, goparageshi zefte ningini. Hambra, rigida, balagashi zeke mon gombre, tineshi zege ningin. Ra, lingineftu nosh, zepe tengin malagana digidishtun. Rumunon gombre, kitama lagata shi zefte mengidishtun. Zu, rimana, kalapalakeshi sepe tengin. Build yourself up in your most holy faith. Ramana. Father, this morning, I ask you, Spirit, Holy Spirit, would you break off the shackles of fear and tradition and religion? Break off the shackles that we've embraced for so long that's kept us bound up. And you've called us to be an army of God that makes Jesus famous. So I pray, break off the shackles of fear off of our lives. That where we walk, we'll promote Jesus Christ. Where we live, we'll promote Jesus Christ. It's everything towards building the kingdom of God. I pray, Holy Spirit, this morning, break off the shackles of fear. That we will say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. No matter where we go, no matter our age or our pedigree, we say, yes, we will make Christ famous. We will build disciples. We'll build the kingdom of God. I pray that in Jesus' name. Break off the shackles this morning. Come, if the Lord's been speaking to you, I just want you to raise your hands as a sign of you going, Lord, I want that. I want that. Wherever you are in this room, you say, Lord, more freedom for me. More, Lord, over my life. More, Lord. I pray for a courageous spirit. A courageous spirit. I pray for a courageous spirit over us. Gragata palagist. Rigemandan bologoshi zapa bragetan, man. Luftu mongoshi zikipa mambrokuta la pelegifta. Zapa, raga. We have the answer. We have the good news. We have the answer, says the Lord. You have the answer. You've got the Spirit of God resident inside of you. And he says, would you let him out of your mouth? Would you let him out? I pray this. No more fear. No more fear. No more fear. In Jesus' name. I want to share a quick testimony with you while you stand. We went holiday last week in the Drakensberg, and my Averly was busy swimming with a friend that she had made there. And it was our last day, it was our last hour. I took her for a swim quickly before we had to leave. And she was swimming for an hour, and I was sitting by the pool, and this friend's grandfather came to swim with them, and they were having a great time in the pool. And so I called Ava, I said, Ava, we need to go. So she came to me, and I dried her, and we put some clothes on. And as I'm busy with her, drying her, she says, Daddy, can I go and ask my friend if they believe in God? And I'm going, no. We're leaving now. You can't like go to your friend now when we're leaving. You know, if you did this, you should have done this the first day when you played with your friend. And she's like, Daddy, but please, can I go and ask my friend if they believe in God? But you have to understand, the swimming pool is about there. We're sitting here. And she's not in the pool, so she has to shout to her friend, and there's other people. That's the situation. So I'm going, no, Everly, the time's not right. We can't do this right now. And she's persistent. She says, Daddy, can I please ask my friend if they believe in God? And I kept saying, no, no, let's not do that. But you know, inside of you, it's your fear. It's not their fear. And I could have portrayed my fear onto her. And so she was so persistent, I said, Averly, go for it. So she stood at the edge of the pool, and her friend was in the water, and the grandpa was playing, and she says, friend, do you believe in God? I promise you. And the grandpa turned around, and he said, of course we do. You know what? Yeah. It wasn't about the answer. It was about the question. Am I going to be the one that's going to take that step of faith and go, do you believe in God? Because you might die. And I want to get you in the kingdom. Because I love Jesus. Do you believe in Jesus? You see, not do you attend church. Are you willing to surrender to Jesus? Are you willing to believe him? Are you willing to serve him? Are you willing to obey him? This is the call. This is what is in our lives. So Father, I bless us today. I pray that this church, I pray that every person in this church, that the boldness and courage will take over us in this season, where we will start spreading the gospel to the lost, and we have the good news, we have the answers. And I pray for a spirit of boldness and courage over us, that fear will no longer attack us, but we'll just be that candle that shines bright for Jesus. I pray for this. I bless us today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a great Sunday. Can I just say, before you walk out those doors, go and love somebody. Thanks for the guys watching online. Go and love somebody.